You are listening to the Hiking Radio Network, where we talk the walk with shows by hikers about hikers for everybody.
Welcome to the Trail Dames podcast, where we speak with women who love to dance upon this earth. So a few years back, I took a class with my mom. We went out to LA and we took a class in screenwriting. So you're asking yourself, what does this have to do with a podcast and hiking? Not a darn thing. But if you're listening to my podcast, you know that I'm a lifelong learner and I'm very curious. So anyway, I went to take this class on screenwriting. And one of the things I learned was that to create a compelling character, it had to have several facets. And if you start thinking about people, one of the things that makes them really fascinating is when they have lots of different facets. The reason I talk about this is that today's guest is exactly like that. Her name is Jaunting Jan, and you may have already actually heard her on Jester's podcast. It's one of the other podcasts in the Hiking Radio Network. I purposefully have not heard her interview with Jester. I don't know what they talked about because I wanted our conversation to be really fresh. But I can tell you that in my research, looking at her blog and reading all about her, this is what jumped out at me. She's not just one thing. She's a lot of different things. She's motivational. She's a do-it-yourself gear maker. She's a traveler. She was a serious professional work person and became a nomad. So these things, like all these different things, every time I would think I kind of had her figured out, something else would jump out at me and be extra fascinating. So I'm really glad you're here today. I think you're going to enjoy listening to our conversation. I learned a lot about Jaunting Jan, and she's going to share all of her stories and her tips and tricks for getting out of our armchairs and getting out there and doing stuff. And after our conversation, do me a favor and just hang out for a few more minutes. I'm going to share some more journal entries from my own Appalachian Trail through hike. I'm so glad you're here. My name is Anna. All my friends call me Mudbutt. And you're listening to the Trail Dames podcast. I'm gonna dance upon this earth. Jan, thank you so much for being on the Trail Dames podcast. I am very, very excited. And I have to tell you, I said this in the intro, but I'm going to tell you because I haven't told you this, that for our listeners, for the Hiking Radio Network listeners that are familiar with Jester's podcast, you've already been on it. I purposefully have not heard that interview because I didn't want it to, like, you know, lead me down one way or the other. I like our conversation to be completely organic, but Jester said you were so much fun. So I'm really looking forward to this.
I love that you didn't listen in advance. I love that we get to have a fresh conversation. And because I have just recently started listening to Trail Dames podcast, I love you as an interviewer.
Oh, thank you. That's so sweet. That like may be one of the best compliments anyone could give me. Because for me, it's very simple. It's just a conversation. It's a conversation with like my idols. You know what I mean? Like I'm talking to people, but I'm kind of getting my fan geekdom on, whatever you call that. And so, because I always want to do what you guys do.
Well, I think that you sort of have that journalism background or something that enables you to ask good questions and listen really well.
Well, I think for me, it's curiosity more than anything, maybe with a nice little dose of female nosiness.
Perfect.
My background. Yeah, it works totally. It works totally. So I am going to just jump right in. Now, I normally start with like, were you a hiker when you were young and all that kind of stuff, but we aren't going to talk about that. But one of the things that really drew me in when I read about you and started looking at your blog and everything is that, you know, you had a career and you were working, but that something happened and wilderness just grabbed your heart and your passion. That's what it seems like happened. Is that the deal?
That is exactly what happened. And I didn't really know. It was such a like sort of slow process. I was in my career, loving my career. And then perimenopause hit. And I struggled. And I remember taking this drive to go visit a friend on this very forested road, hadn't been on a forested road in years, decades, I don't know. And I just felt alive. I could smell the pine trees. And I was just like, I need to be there. I need to figure out either a second home, a cabin. I need to do something different. Well, I was thinking that was kind of like a seed. And then I was aware of people my age that were starting to have ailments and illnesses. And my dad had, we had grown up being outdoors. And then my dad got hurt when I was 12. And that was kind of the end of it. And so I was like, you know, he had this great retirement plan and it never happened. I didn't really know what I was going to do when I was retired. I just knew that I was going to retire young. Like I was going to stop working so that I could live at some point because I had this great career. I knew I couldn't keep it up. I knew I couldn't keep working those hours and using my brain the way I was. Then I had kind of a life-altering experience. I was shot in a drive-by shooting.
Oh my gosh.
I was riding my bike when it happened. And when that happens, you realize like, oh my gosh, like that could have been the end. What would have I regretted? I would have regretted that I did not live a very balanced life. I was all work, no play. And I just gave it my all. And I was like that when I went to school. I was always destination, no journey. It was always like, get to the end, do what you need to do. And when that happened, I was just like, oh my gosh. And then I saw like these things that happen to people so they never got to enjoy their retirement. And I'm just like, I don't want to be one of those people. How can I start transitioning to live this different life? And about that time, right around probably 50 by now, meetup groups were starting to come around here. And I just happened to look online and look for a hiking group. And there weren't any yet, but there was an older hiking group that was still in existence. So I went and did a couple hikes with them and I'm like, ooh, hiking. I like this.
So where was that? Where that did was, you live with at that point?
So when I was living in far Northern California when that opportunity happened. And I was raised right by the Oregon border in California. And so this is kind of my backyard. I'm living an hour and a half from where I was raised.
Oh, okay. Gotcha. So I want to just jump back for a really quick second. So being shot in a drive-by shooting, that seems unbelievably random, first of all. I mean, you know, I guess it really is unbelievably random. But mentally, I understand that you thought, oh my gosh, you know, I haven't done all these things and now I get to do all these things. But also, did you have anything, did it frustrate you? Were you upset that you out of the entire world got shot by this stupid situation? Do you know what I mean?
Oh, you have no idea. Yeah, that was, I mean, I went through a lot. In fact, there was a secret witness posting for my incident. I was riding my bike. It was Easter Sunday morning. It was in town. It was completely obnoxious. And it was done by two young guys. And it was before social media. And yeah, it was traumatic. Like, oh my gosh. And I remember saying, I will go to therapy. I will do whatever I need to do so that it doesn't steal my joy. And at that time, my joy was bike riding because that was something I could do solo. It was something I could do to balance with work. It was my exercise. And I'm just like, I can't let that get stolen from me. And I think that, yes. And it's still here.
So I know you already have your blog and everything, but I think that's a title of a book. You know, I'm not going to let it steal my joy. I'm so impressed with that because to me, this sounds like a really scary situation. I think I'd probably curl up in a ball for a while.
It was definitely traumatizing as far as saying like how weird that this happened, but more importantly, what could have happened? Like I felt like I got away with just, I used up one of my nine lives, but it wasn't the nine lives.
Gotcha. And you said it's still with you. Did you actually mean your injury?
Well, yes, my injury is still with me, but more important, like it always is in the back of my head. Like I know that I lived through being shot and I can be strong. And I know that, you know, worse things might happen. And I use it a lot when people say, aren't you scared? And I say, what's the worst can happen? I might be shot. Like I lived through it.
I love that. That's true. And you know, what an amazing mindset then to take into the wilderness, you know, when you go, this idea that, you know, might be scary, but I've survived scary things before.
It helps me a lot when I'm doing especially front country camping and stuff. And we'll talk about that a little bit, but it really helps me think about and be prepared for, okay, some things are just out of your control. Like there was nothing I could have done different.
Right. Absolutely. That I totally understand. No fault, no intention, none of that stuff. It just, that's kind of, I think what I was thinking about random. So, all right. So let me ask you, so you were talking about perimenopause and you were talking about riding through that down that road to your friend's house. Are you a person that feels like energy around you? Like you can feel if somebody's happy or sad or that kind of thing?
Not so much. I'm definitely more of the cut and dry, practical person.
Gotcha. Well, the reason I ask is that for me, when I'm driving down a Forest Service road in the woods, like
yes,
there's a specific energy there that I can really feel. And it, I don't know, it heals me and excites me and makes me see a bigger picture. Like it's a feeling that I just wondered if that's something that you were feeling when you were driving down that road.
Well, maybe. I definitely remember the smell. I remember opening my windows and just that smell and feeling so happy. Like I hadn't felt that happy and light for a long time.
Yeah. It's a smell like no other, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So how did you go from, first of all, being shot, then perimenopause, in which I'm menopausal and I know what you mean about that just being hard and it kind of messes with your head, to becoming a woman that sleeps in her car half of a year. So if our listeners don't know, on your blog, you talk about this and you talk about how in 2019, you actually kind of turned into a nomad and you lived in your car for 123 nights.
So it kind of happened accidentally. Like I feel like there's a lot of stuff that I don't really plan that you just... When you had Zoe on, it just reminded me of me because I am a yes person and things happen and I say yes and then opportunities open the door. And when I very first, I guess my big first yes as a retired person was in early 2015, and I had an opportunity to join a Gossamer Gear Ambassador event in Moab. And in fact, that was when Joan and I Hemlock, when we really got together and got to know each other, we both said, are you going? Are you going? What if we go? And I said, well, I'm going to drive. So if you want to stay extra, let's do that. So we did. We both went. We made a huge connection and networking. And it was like the perfect opportunity to get to do things I hadn't done, be outside my comfort zone. And then we spent the next 2 weeks just figuring out where we might want to go and see. She was in her tent at the time, and I started sleeping in my car. So I'm like, why set up a tent if I'm just going to sleep right outside the door of my car? Like, my car's already set up. I don't have to set up the tent. I don't have to clean it up. It's all ready. So I did that. And then I would kind of, that year as I traveled, I would stay in motels. And every time I did, I hated it. Like, it stunk. It had weird, you know, everything. You had weird noises. I didn't sleep very good. And I'm like, I'm sleeping better in my car. And I really don't have a very big budget. And it just kind of evolved over that first year of I'll try more and more places to see if I can figure out this where I can sleep between trailheads. Because really all I'm doing is driving between trailheads. It's not like I'm out sightseeing. It's not like I'm in cities. I'm avoiding cities. I'm avoiding anything that has busy traffic. I want to be out in the woods. I want to spend as much time as I can hiking and backpacking.
Okay, I do want to ask you this kind of question. So I am not someone that ever gets scared when I'm out hiking and all that kind of stuff. And I hate having the conversation about fear for women in the outdoors. However, I am going to say this because I want to know how you feel about it. When I have slept in my car many times because like you said, you know, I'm sorry. If you don't have to put up the tent and all that, it's great. You know, I'm not going to get rained on. I love sleeping in my car. However, I've always felt a little bit more vulnerable in my car. With a tent, I can go off between trees and nobody's going to find me. But with a car, it's so visible. Do you ever feel like that? Or do you just feel 100% safe and at home in your car?
I don't feel 100% safe, but I do feel way better dispersed camping than in campgrounds. I really don't like campgrounds. I will avoid campgrounds. There is definitely risk by going off and dispersed camping, where my preference is not to see a car. So I am really out there by myself.
All right. So what is dispersed camping?
So people on the East Coast don't have dispersed camping. On the West Coast, we can camp on Forest Service land and BLM land in most places. There are some rules, but basically if there's a Forest Service road or a BLM road, you can find a place to camp. There's usually like side little roads that you can pull off on. And some of them are nice. They even might have a fire ring, or they might have a picnic table, but mostly it's just a pull off. And you're off of maybe a main Forest Service road onto a secondary road.
And how do you find your way?
There's a lot of different ways, but Gaia I use a lot. Gaia shows public lands, and so that's one of my main ways. There are a few other resources where you can get ideas of places near, like maybe major roads that have free camping, and it's called freecamping.net or something like that.
So what is Gaia? Because I've never used Gaia.
So Gaia is the most amazing mapping system for hikers, backpackers. And now they do even water travel, but they have layers on it. And you can get your National Geographic maps. You can get snow angles. You can see how much snow there is in places. Oh my gosh, it has so much stuff. It has air quality and temperatures, so you can see where there's smokes and fires. It's an amazing resource. But for me, I use the public lands layer to know where I can camp, and it'll show like all the roads and stuff.
So I will, just for our listeners, I'm going to put the link to that in the show notes. Of course, I have the link to all of Jan's stuff too, but I want to just throw that in there. So people can, you don't have to turn off the recording, keep listening, but you can go back later and access it. So I do have to say one more thing too. I'm like you, I hate campgrounds. I think it's like the fifth circle of hell. But I think the reason campgrounds exist is that people are desperate for that smell that we smell when we drive down a Forest Service road, because that smell is in all the campgrounds. And it's a beautiful thing. So if that's what it takes for people to get out and get that smell, more power to them.
I also think it really is a good place for that percentage of the population that wants kind of the Disneyland environment.
True. And if you have kids that want to meet other kids and other campsites and that kind of thing. I grew up camping. I have to say, I grew up thinking that KOA was like the greatest place ever. We would go out west every summer in our Volkswagen van, my family. And I loved campgrounds because we would meet kids from all over the country. Site over, there were kids. Okay, we will leave that for another podcast because neither one of us are campground people. So I have to like jump. So I made notes and I had questions and I have like a little outline, and I'm totally throwing that all away because I have to jump in and I'm going to ask you something. So, you started this whole conversation talking about going from being a workaholic to being this nomad loving the wilderness. And you also mentioned being a real yes person. Me too. This is why you and I already feel like friends, because we're both serious yes people. You put in one of your blog entries, you wrote a blog and you said in there, you asked your readers, are you a stewer or are you a doer? Now, I've never heard that statement before, but I loved it. It kind of just grabbed me. And I want to know what that actually means. Tell me what a stewer is, because I know which one you are, but what is that?
Well, I wrote that blog post because I felt like I heard so many people. I guess I'm going to back up. I used to host hikes through meetup groups a lot, and I met a ton of people through that. And I've also been involved in some of the Facebook groups. And there's a lot of people on there that say they want to, are going to do, but can't make that leap to doing it. And so they think about it. It's that analysis paralysis, or it's fear, or it's whatever it is that makes you just think about it. I helped this one gal get ready for the PCT, and she bought all her gear. She was so excited, but she could not take a step on a trail. I actually ended up going and meeting with her, and helped her do her first 3 miles on that trail. And she just wanted it so bad, but she just couldn't do it. She could not just take that next step.
Well, now, were you, okay, so a stewer is somebody that just stews in the idea, but doesn't move forward?
That's how I think of it. I think of it as somebody that just wants to. They want it so bad, but they just can't take that next step.
So I have known a lot of people like that, and I actually was like that much of my life. And my question for you is, were you ever a stewer and then at some point became a doer, or were you always just a doer?
I was always a doer. If I wasn't committed to doing something, I would never say yes. I would say, you know, like, I need to research it more. Let me think about it, or no. And I'm really good at saying no. And I think that, you know, that's hard for so many people, especially women, to say no. And I'm pretty confident in saying, you know, no, I don't want to do that. Or no, I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to have the money, or I'm not going to have the time. Where other people will say, yeah. And then the last minute, no. And in fact, that's how I became a solo backpacker, because I first planned a trip with a group of six people and everybody's yes. And it comes down to no. And so I had the opportunity and I'm like, you're ready. Let's just do it. Go.
So where was your first solo backpacking trip?
It was in Washington on the PCT through the Goat Rocks Wilderness.
Oh, I bet it was gorgeous.
It was the most like, oh, it was so perfect for me because it was during prime season. And so I knew that if something happened, I would have help. And it's one of the three sections I would say that PCT hikers say are their favorite sections. And so I had done stuff in California. I'm like, I want to do something that's in Washington. And so I got the opportunity and it was gorgeous. My timing was perfect. It was beautiful. I learned a lot of things about myself. And the biggest thing I learned was, if you have time and you want to see something, do it. Don't live with regrets. Don't say, I wish I would have. And there was one section there that's called Goat Lake. And I saw it from the trail and I said, I want to spend the night at Goat Lake. But I was so determined to get to the end and I was worried about my timing, my food and all those things. And I didn't. And so I've regretted it since then. And that was 2013, 14, somewhere in there. And just 2 years ago, I went back and I did the loop that included the lake.
Oh, that's awesome. That's, you know, I have to tell you, I have a wonderful friend who shall remain unnamed because I'm hoping she'll be on the podcast one day and then she can share her the story herself. But she did the entire Appalachian Trail and she told me later, and she finished early. She was done like September 3rd, something, you know, and she told me later, she thought about all those, like the side trails, the waterfalls, the taking the time that she skipped because she was afraid she would run out of time. And that, and how she really wished she had taken some more time. And that's so interesting. There's got to be a name for people like that, you know, that end result kind of holds you hostage if you're not careful.
I feel like it was such a good learning experience and it has become now my way of hiking. So now I tend to say, I'm just going to take a week's worth of food and I'm going to park my car here and I'm going to go and do whatever I want to do. And I know that just my food limits my time. And I can do a loop. I can do out and backs. I can do spurs. I can do whatever I want. I can stay an extra day at a lake. All I have to do is get back to my car with the food.
All right. So I want to go back. So, because your attitude is so wonderful. And I think that we can all learn a lot from it. So like I mentioned earlier, I spent a lot of my life as a stewer. I mean, in fact, the book that you're recently were featured in, and we're going to get to that in a second. I used to read these books all the time, all about women doing amazing things. And I tell the story on the podcast, I've told it before, that I got angry one day and I threw the book across the room and said, I was tired of reading about these women. I wanted to become one of these women. So I actually know that it's possible to go from being a stewer to a doer. And I want our listeners who are armchair hikers, who are dreamers, I do want them to know how possible it is. So do me a favor, give them some steps they can take, some ideas that makes them know that they can actually get out and actually do something.
I think it's the baby steps. I think it's the don't feel like you have to have all your gear. Don't feel like you have to go out and do a backpacking trip as your first thing. Here's another like sort of story that I learned about, and you probably have experienced this through the Trail Dames. I had through our meetup group, we were very open and welcoming. It was like the best group for me to join because they filled my calendar. The gal that organized it was very open and inviting. Well, we did this camp out trip and this gal showed up with her ex-husband. And she told us how many times she'd tried to come to our events. She sat outside in her car and she was too scared. She was too scared to take that step to come meet us, even though she knew, like none of us knew each other. We were all like, come, welcome, we'll meet you. And so when she came with her ex-husband as her security blanket, she was so happy and it was such like a great experience. And then she sent him away. The next day she's like, I'm fine. I know these people, I can stay now. And it's those kind of things like you just have to say, I know it's like going to a new school. It's awkward. I'm going to be uncomfortable, but everybody was new. Everybody wants me here. Like I just have to join. And I think that joining a group really helps you, your learning curve and your confidence. I don't recommend doing solo stuff at the beginning.
Yeah, I agree completely. I did all of my hiking solo from the very beginning because there was no such thing as meetup and all that. And having a group that's welcoming, and there are groups all over this country. You can find them through the American Hiking Society. You can find them through Sierra Club, through meetup, through whatever. Of course, through Trail Dames, we would love to have everybody. But we talk about that all the time in Trail Dames, that the bravest thing a woman can do is pull up in the parking lot. Because if you look at a group of dames getting ready to go hike, even though half of them may be new, we look like we've all known each other forever. And when you're sitting in your car and you look out and everybody's all colorful, they're clothes, they've got backpacks, and they all look like pros. Now, half of them it's their first hike ever, but there's something that happens when you're sitting in that car and they all look like pros and you're sure you don't belong. And if you can just open the door and step out. That yep. Like you were saying, if you could just find that strength, that one step. And I love what you said about the baby steps. I think that that's the secret to everything.
Yeah, it really is. Because I think that if you put everything in one basket and you've like, I'm kind of like what you've talked about on a couple of the other podcasts of, I'm not going to do this until, I'm going to wait until everything's perfect. It's never going to be perfect.
No, no. Until is a terrible word. Wait is also, I'm not a good waiter. Very, I'm not good at waiting for anything. But so, all right, well, let me ask you this. So you've retired, you've become this nomad, and you've become inordinately comfortable in the outdoors. I can tell that by reading your blog and everything. And so neat to see. How did you become a writer in a book?
So how that happened, I can't really tell you exactly, but I will tell you that I used to write a lot and teach a lot at my job. And I really enjoyed that part, was mentoring and working with people. And so when I was transitioning from my job and I was working with, I was hosting meetup groups and meeting all these people, they kept asking me the same questions. Where to hike? Where do you hike? Where do you hike? What do you do? What is it? And we didn't really have anything in my area yet. And so I started building the blog to introduce people in my area to what they could do after work, on the weekends, whatever. And then, and I would do links to trail, to maps, blah, blah, blah. Then people started asking me about gear. And so I did a couple presentations. And of course, the material was so much. I'm like, I can't do this. Like, you know, you can't do it in 2 hours. You can't do it in an hour. It's just like so much information. And I kept repeating myself and I didn't feel like it was clear. I'm like, okay, my blog is really about gear now. So now it had two sections. And I found that I just like enjoyed that as a process. And as I started traveling, I really liked sharing and people wanted to know, like, where have you been? Where should I go? Okay, I'm going to Utah. And I'm like, okay, well, now these are the places I've been. Look at my pictures, see if something interests you and I'll give you additional information. I did it sort of for them, sort of for me, so that I could look back and have memories. And I had easy resources. I did links on everything so I could find my maps and find what the rules were. And somehow I got picked up and invited to participate in the book. I know some of the other people in the book, and I suspect that one of them had mentioned my name or two of them, because there are a few people that hike together in the Bay Area that I know and that said, oh, there's this other person that does writing and that's out there doing wild things. And she's over age 45.
So let me tell our listeners. So Susan Alcorn wrote this book, and it's called Walk, Hike, Saunter, Seasoned Women Hikers Share Tales and Trails. So it's narrative nonfiction, it's first-person stories and essays, all about women's experiences on the trail, basically. I love these books. These books are so great because they really do show you how women from every walk of life all can come together to love the wilderness and love the outdoors. So yeah, I don't know if you've set out to become a published author, but you are now.
I actually didn't think like, I like the way I do my blog because I can just do, I sort of do photo descriptions to tell the story. And it worked really well in Susan's book because she sent out surveys to ask us questions. So kind of like in a podcast format, like answer these questions and tell me about, you know, blah, blah, blah. I'm really good at that stuff too. Writing a whole book, I don't know. You know, several people are like, please do a coffee table book with all your photos. Yes, I love taking photos. Maybe someday, but right now I just want to hike and backpack and be out there. I don't want to spend my time doing this.
Yeah. And you know, I will tell you this because your pictures are gorgeous, but doing a coffee table book, talk about a time suck. You spend the next 2 years embroiled in that project and your blog is wonderful. And so I love the way you have it laid out. First of all, I love that geographically, because as soon as I went to, I think it's the, I don't know if you call it a homepage, whatever, you know, and I saw Arizona, New Mexico, Utah. Oh my gosh. I started getting excited. I'm like, because I have hiked to some of those places and I want to hike other of those places. So I love that. But then I love, you've got a whole section on do it yourself where you share your MacGyver techniques and how you, in fact, I wanted to ask you about that because I thought that was a really cool facet to your blog that you're actually either making or altering gear. Is that something that you find yourself doing a lot?
I do. I've always been a problem solver and I started sewing quite young. I was making all my clothes by the time I was in sixth grade and I made my first down coat by the time I was in high school, I think. And I was making suits for work. And when I started hiking, I was just like, what don't they have? What doesn't work for me? What can I make that's better? And then it's like, this is a lot of money. This is big, expensive stuff. And I'm not really somebody that just throws away things when it's not really used up. If it's not worn out, how can I like fix it? And so that's kind of how things came about. The hardest one was my converting my sleeping bag to a quilt because it was an expensive sleeping bag. And it was like, it wasn't working. It wasn't exactly what I wanted, but I knew like you take that first cut and it's going to add weight and it's going to change things. And so the first thing I did was add length because it wasn't quite long enough. So I just added some down to the top and that I used that for a while and I'm like, okay, I like it way better. And then I'm like, okay, I think I'm just going to cut the zipper out and make it a quilt. If I do that, oh my gosh.
Oh my God.
And then I'm like, well, if I'm going to do that, it could really use some more down. The down, by now, I think it was like 5 or 6 years old. And I'm like, the down is getting pretty bad. I wonder if I can do this. So I bought down and I went on and learned how to stuff it. And they're like, get inside the bathtub and close the door and close your shower curtain and start stuffing. And I did it and it worked and I got it all sewed up. And I was like, oh my gosh, this is so much better. I love my quilt now.
Okay, this may be the bravest thing I ever heard anyone say, because I am picturing my beloved Montbell down sleeping bag, which I adore and which costs more than I should have spent on a sleeping bag. The idea of taking scissors to it just freaks me out totally.
It was scary. But at that point, it was like, okay, you know, one of the things that I like to do is say dollar per use. My work life, I did a lot of financial stuff and I'm like, okay, so this sleeping bag cost XYZ. How many nights have you used it? You have gotten your money's worth. Like if you, the worst case scenario, it's not working for you and you're going to have to replace it. In the reality, you have slept in it more than anybody has slept in a sleeping bag. Like it's okay if you have to replace it.
I love that. I love that dollar per use. I think that's a really great way to think about gear all the time. Because a lot of times we need to alter our gear, but we find ourselves buying new ones or we think, oh, I don't deserve new gear. I've only had it 5 years or whatever. Oh, dollar per use. Yeah.
dollar per use. Yeah, especially like tents. And when you're still using your tent, I had a really like one of those things that you go, I don't need this, but I really hate my orange tent. And they came out in forest green, in sage green. And I really like to hide and do that, you know, where nobody really sees you. And I had to work really hard on myself to say, but my other tent is really fine. I don't really need this tent, but on a dollar per year, I'm probably down to a penny, you know? It's on sale. It's 60% off. It's cheaper than when I bought the first one. I know I love this tent. It works for me. Joan was the one that said, do it. Pull the trigger. Pull the trigger. And I did.
I'm a big believer in deserving things. And I pretty much believe I deserve anything that I want. And so buying new gear is never a problem because I hold it up and I'm like, Now, once I started Trail Dames, it became a piece of cake because I knew if I don't use it, I can loan it out to other dames. Then all of a sudden it becomes, then it's just generous, right? Well, I have to buy it so I can share it with my friends. So.
I had more of that philosophy when I was working. Once you don't have income, so I am not working. I'm not really retired because I don't have a pension. I'm really like living on frugal savings. And so you do think much differently when all of a sudden you're like, oh, that's all that's left in my bank account. And I don't want to go back to work. So I need it to last.
So speaking of which, so something tells me that if you do go back to work or when you do need more money, that it won't be back to your old life. So have you given thought to ways that you can turn your love into a money-making, self-supporting thing? You know what I mean?
I have thought about it and I'm not ready. Like, I feel like, yes, I could monetize my blog. Yes, I could do some of those things. But I feel like it takes away from it. And at this point, I'd still prefer to live frugally, live in my car, make my own food, do the things that I can do without having to work. Like, yeah, there's plenty of things I could do later. And then I feel like, you know, there is a end point to hiking and backpacking, being able to do it full time like I do it. And at that point, I'll be ready to think of other options. I always tease and say, I'm going to be a Walmart greeter. I feel like that would be great. You're like, hi, how are you doing? I could be an REI greeter. I don't know.
Yes, you would be great. I can tell you that.
Yeah. And volunteer positions are great too. So.
Yeah. I was actually thinking of like a park ranger or something like that. Oh, you'd be brilliant at that because in case our listeners can't tell, you are such an easy conversationalist and you have a lot of knowledge and you love the outdoors. You'd be great at that.
Yes, it's definitely on my list. In fact, this winter I had looked at a position that was a volunteer position at Bryce and I was going to go do that. And then instead I had a little knee surgery and I'm in rehab. So that was the end of that. It was right at the time I would have applied for it.
So your knee is getting better, I'm assuming.
Yes.
Good. So what are you looking at in terms of a timeline being able to get back out there again?
That is still the big question. So far, all of the expectations and timelines that have been set have not been true. They originally told me I could start hiking on easy trails in April, and that is what I'm still holding to. But at this point, I am still walking with a crutch.
You know, crutch, hiking pole, tomato, tomato. I see you out there in April for sure.
Believe me, I'm holding on to it.
Yeah. So I told you I had all my questions and everything, and I just totally threw it out the window. And because I want to actually finish up with what I was going to ask you very first. And that is, you're not the first person I've met, but you're one of the very few people I've met that you have actually two trail names. And I want you to tell us how you got your trail names.
Okay. BeeKeeper was my first trail name and is my real trail name. And it came about by the first person that introduced me to the PCT. I didn't know growing up that the PCT was in my backyard. I had no idea. Found out that somebody from my high school helped build it. And then when I moved and started the meetup, was with the meetup group, I met this gal and her significant other was a section hiker. And they decided to schedule a camp out where they were introducing us all to the PCT. I got to meet my first through hikers. My very first one was from Israel and we got to hand them trail magic. That was amazing. It was at the halfway point of the PCT. And so we got to see everybody celebrating and that was exciting. And while we were there, of course, we got to hear everybody's stories about trail names. So this gal that was the host was like, okay, your trail name is Queen Bee. And I said, no, I'm a queen bee at work. I am not going to be a queen bee in my trail life. She's like, no, you're already a queen bee because you bring everybody together and you've been coordinating all these hikes. You've been an event host, blah, blah, blah. But you're really the keeper of the bees. You're like the one that's the cheerleader. You're the one that encourages everybody to come and join. So you're really the beekeeper. And I'm like, okay, it's not real original, but it has an original meaning because it's the antithesis of queen bee. So I took it. And that became my trail name. And it's been fun. Like, I'm actually allergic to bees. And so it's kind of funny to say, oh, I'm a queen bee, but not really. So that's what it was. And then somewhere along the line, and I don't even know exactly how it happened, it became, oh, so I started Jan's Jaunts as my my blog. And then I had to come up with a name for Instagram, and I put Jaunting Jan. And then when I came up with my Facebook page, I'm like, Jaunting Jan. And then all of a sudden, everybody's like, knows me because I changed my personal page to Jaunting Jan also. Because now that I was out traveling so much, I'm like, people don't really need to know my last name. And that gives me a little bit more security. I'll just become Jaunting Jan.
Well, I have to tell you, that's so funny because the way the Trail Names podcast is set up for the show notes and stuff, Steve has me put a hiker's real name first and last, and then their trail name. That's how each interview is listed. And I could not find your last name, and I'm pretty good at digging. But then I went back and I looked up Jester's podcast, and she didn't have your last name either. I'm like, okay, great. Then we're good. Steve's not going to yell at me. He knows. And I love that. I love that you have actually truly become and lived Jaunting Jan.
Well, this will tell you how much it was. When I went and saw the surgeon for my knee, and he asked about me and how this happened, and I said, honestly, you've got to fix me because this is my life. Like, hiking is my life. And he put that in his chart notes because, of course, we can see our electronic chart notes now. And so then when I went to physical therapy, and that was the first thing I said is, hiking is my life. Like, you, I don't know what to do if I can't do this again. And it's great for them to know that, like, that's my next chapter, and I don't know what I'll do next. I haven't figured out a plan B.
Well, it's great for them to know that. But I love doctors and medical people who respect that. He listened, he wrote it in your chart. It became a real thing. That's awesome. I want to shake your doctor's hand for doing that.
Yes.
Well, I have to tell you, you know, so I've enjoyed talking to you so much. And one of the reasons is, like, you're amazingly multifaceted. And, you know, we talked earlier about your blog, and we talked about the geography, and, you know, it's got gorgeous pictures and stories, and your do-it-yourself. There's also a whole lot of motivational, inspirational stuff. And any hiker, anybody who wants to find something can find it in your blog. There's a lot of different kinds of things. You bring so much of yourself to it, but not just one self, lots of selves. And I just think that's pretty amazing.
Thank you. That's how the whole section on just some jabbering started, because I was just like, I felt like I wanted to share things. I shared things through COVID. I shared things of, like, my struggles. There's those types of people that love exercise, that love staying consistent, and consistency has been a problem for me. And maybe it, you know, contributed to my injury. I feel like I try, and now that I'm retired, I could do it more, but you still have to motivate yourself. You still have to say, get out there every day or whatever and go do it. And a lot of times I have to do it by myself just because people aren't available.
Well, I think that you've shown how you can reach down inside and find the motivation and the strength to do those things. And I think our listeners have really gotten a lot of that from you. So thank you. Thank you. Thank you. My last request is, so when you do get back out there and you start hiking again, come back on, because I saw all the list of all the different trails you've been on. We have a lot more talking to do.
Yes, we do. And if I really get my dream come true this summer, or it may have to wait one more summer, I will spend a whole summer in Colorado.
Ooh, that sounds nice. We want to hear all about it when it happens.
Definitely.
Thank you so much for being on the podcast. We appreciate you and hope you have a fabulous rest of your January.
Thank you. I can't wait to dance on this earth with you. So nice to meet you, Anna.
Great to meet you, too. I'm gonna dance upon this earth. So you see what I mean about her being really multifaceted. I found her fascinating. And I found myself, when I was looking at her blog, oh my gosh, wanting to go out west and hike. We didn't talk about it all that much during this particular interview, but let me tell you, the woman has been all over Washington State, Utah, Arches, Bryce, you name it, all these amazing places. If you love to read about hiking out west, definitely go check out her blog. All of the links are in the show notes, so you can find them there. I really appreciate you joining me. Now sit back while I share just a couple of my Appalachian Trail Journal entries with you. Thanks so much for listening to the Trail Dames podcast. I'm gonna dance upon this earth. July 21st. Today, we are officially, finally in the Shenandoah National Park. And I reached the 400-mile mark in my hike. Woohoo! Actually, I am proud of the 400, but I am chomping at the bit to hit 500. I should hit it within 7 or 8 days, and we're going to go do something special to celebrate. The Aqua Blaze canoe trip is over for the season, unless you can get to the River Runners headquarters. They are near my 500-mile mark, so we may still get to canoe, or we may visit the Luray Caverns, which are also near it. In any case, I am going to celebrate. The Shenandoahs are a really big deal for the thru-hiker. Supposedly, when you are in the park, the trail is much easier, making for higher mileage days. It is a place where many thru-hikers hit that elusive 20-mile day. Also, supposedly, there are quite a few waysides and snack bars, so we don't need to carry much food, thus lowering our pack weight significantly. Well, I will tell you that so far, the park looks exactly like the rest of Virginia. Lots of rocks and lots of elevation change. However, I am withholding judgment until I have been here for a few days. We did encounter some magic and some wonderful people today. The hike dawned hot and muggy. We immediately began climbing up and down over the rocky trail. It was a long, tiring morning, and we were happy to finally take a break. When we sat down to lunch, we were back in the shade on a grassy shoulder of the Skyline Drive. We were tossing around the idea of getting a ride up to the snack bar for a drink. We are so hot. As we sat there dreaming of an ice-cold Coca-Cola, we knew that we weren't actually going to take the time to go get one. We didn't even know where one was. So instead, we started dreaming that one of the cars full of tourists that were whisking by would see us. They'd be moved by the fact that we were hiking in this heat, pull up and offer us an ice chest full of ice-cold Coke. Of course, there was no auto pull-off where we were, and the traffic could not even see us. But we did not let these facts get in the way of our dreaming. As we were getting ready to leave, a road crew pulled up near us to lock up the tractor for the night. When the park ranger got out, I asked him on a whim, "How far is it to the nearest cold drink?" He said it's about 25 miles, but that he had ice water we could have. Oh my, I wish you could know how amazing that ice water was. I was so grateful. We were standing by his truck enjoying this cool, unexpected treat when, without a word, he opened an ice chest and handed us one shining, dripping, glorious, ice-cold Coca-Cola. Who says there is no such thing as magic? He left us there on the side of Skyline Drive with our mouths hanging open and gratitude pouring off of us. It was the best Coke I ever had. While the magic was, well, magical, the hike itself today was kind of strange and disjointed. You would get good and used to the rocks, and then all of a sudden, you'd be walking through stunted pine trees that covered the trail with needles. No sooner would you get used to that than you would find yourself in a big meadow with waist-high undergrowth that threatened to grab you and hold on as you hiked by. However, even when the trail is unpredictable, I find that I'm learning and growing every day. At one point, I was hiking along, going uphill, sweating profusely, yuck, brushing up against stinging nettle, ouch, and periodically stopping to pick the ticks off my legs, ick. It did not occur to me until several hours later that all of that had become commonplace. You would think that the above scenario would be miserable, but it's just part of daily life on the trail. It made me feel good to know that I could keep on hiking with a good attitude despite all the seemingly negative little things, and that I could keep from letting these little things get me down. Late in the afternoon, I came down into a gap and found Bumpkin waiting for me. As we sat there, a truck drove by. I playfully said, "Don't just drive by, stop and give us something to drink." Would you believe that that truck immediately pulled in, a woman rolled down the window and said, "How are you guys fixed for water?" I immediately burst out laughing. You have to understand, many of the hikers out here feel like they're entitled to special treatment. They expect magic, and they're disappointed when they don't get it. Bob and I are not like that. We know that we are out here of our own choosing. If we suffer, it's our own fault. When something magical and wonderful like this happens, we're just so amazed and so grateful. In any case, this is how we met Buzz and Chris, two day hikers that have dreams of doing the trail one day. We stood and talked about hiking in the AT for a long time. They were just as nice as they could be, and they looked like they have exactly what it takes to do a through hike. After feeding us two bottles of water, they drove off to the sound of our thank yous. I would not be a bit surprised to see them on Springer Mountain next March. As we hiked, we kept an eye out for my friends Anthony and Ann Carroll. They are up here, and they had plans to try and find us in the park. We never did find them, but I was so touched that they would even make the effort. Finding a through hiker on the AT is not the easiest thing in the world, and I really appreciate that they made the effort. The sun was setting when we finally found a small campsite. We were both tired from our day, but felt good to be back in our tents. There's no place like home, and for now, the tent is home. Tomorrow, maybe we'll get to see what all of this fuss is about when it comes to the Shenandoahs. Love, Mudbutt. July 22nd. Have you heard Virginia's state motto, Virginia is for lovers? Well, out here on the AT, we have good-naturedly changed that to Virginia is for liars. For years, we have been told that Virginia is easy. We've been told that Virginia is fairly flat, and we have been told that the Shenandoah National Park is flat, easy, smooth, and covered with places to buy food. Lies. All lies. Now, I will say that as of today, much of the trail was smooth and well-groomed, and the ups and downs were well-graded. But a lot of the trail was still hard, and a lot of the trail was uphill. Of course, for the last 10 years, people also said that it is all hard. There are just relative states of difficulty. However, like all dreamers, I refuse to listen to anything resembling reason, so I find myself here in the Shenandoah National Park feeling somewhat cheated. I guess that will teach me to bury my head in the sand. Today's hike was long and arduous for both Bumpkin and I. We were having such a hard time finding that rhythm that we had a week ago. I think that I've learned some hard-earned lessons. No more consecutive slack-packing days. You lose your trail legs a little bit each time you do it. One day is fine, but more than that, and we are just asking for re-entry problems. The trail was hard, but it sure was neat. Much of it was beautiful, and we did a lot of ridge walking, so the views were varied, and they're really stunning. The trail, like yesterday, changed a lot throughout the day. One change that was welcome was the return of the blueberries. All of a sudden, they are everywhere, and they are so ripe. I sported a purple tongue for much of the day, which by itself isn't too bad. However, when you add the purple hands I got from all the ripe blackberries that I found, well, I probably looked a little strange. My favorite part of the trail today was an area that had been scarred by a wildfire. So imagine this: bright blue skies, black charred pine trees, and waist-high undergrowth in every shade of bright green you can imagine. The contrast between the sky and the undergrowth and those gnarled, creepy-looking pine trees is stark. The desolation of the burnt trees mixed with the vibrant plant life gives you the idea that the forest is springing back to life. However, I know better. A forest ranger friend of mine taught me that all that scrub growth isn't considered true growth. It'll take many years for this forest to look like it did. In the meantime, however, it sure is something to see. There were several highlights to the day in addition to the beauty. We met a young couple out for a section hike, and it turns out that they are vocal students in college. When we asked what they did, they both said that they were opera singers. Bumpkin sat back and said, "Well, I might as well get comfortable. This is going to be a long conversation." Well, it didn't take too long, but it was nice to meet other classical musicians on the trail. We will be hiking in the general vicinity for a while, so hopefully we will get more chances to spend time with them. The funniest part of the day was when all four of us were sitting by the road eating lunch. Having just told them the story of the trail magic we had encountered yesterday, I shouted out at a passing truck, "Ooh, you don't have anything for us to drink, do you?" And would you believe, the truck pulled right in.
Looking up, I saw our friends from yesterday afternoon, Buzz and Chris. Talk about a small world. Well, we didn't really need anything to drink. Instead, we spent a few minutes swapping trail stories before they took off again. I just know that next year, I'm going to be doing trail magic somewhere, and they're going to walk right up. I cannot wait. As the hiking came to a close, I arrived at the shelter. The weatherman said that big storms are coming this way, and sure enough, they hit as soon as dinner is over. I chat with the vocalist for a few minutes after they arrive before finally wrapping myself up in the sleeping bag. Tomorrow, we hike into the campground. Another AT day has come and gone. Love, Mudbug.